Welcome to my channel.
Shorty won $1 million.
The trials of Gabriel Fernandez. The name of the trial was called, and I'm gonna be referring back to my notes.
The case is gonna be very emotional, so at any point you find yourself getting a little overwhelmed, please step out of the courtroom, compose yourself, and then come back inside.
Hello everyone, welcome back to my channel. I am Bri on TV. If you're new to my channel, thank you so much for taking the time out of your day to watch this video. If you are a returning subscriber or supporter, thank you as well for clicking on the video and tuning in. Today we're going to be talking about a very serious topic. It's a Netflix documentary called The Trials of Gabriel Fernandez. I'm not going to assume that you know exactly what I'm talking about. So in this video, I will be breaking down per episodes, just everything that went on in the documentary, how I felt about it, certain things that I still feel like I, you know, have questions about, or just it wasn't clear to me. And the point of this video is really to just like have an open forum of discussion with anybody else who also watched it and was just left really like shook, or just like I need to just like vent to somebody or discuss, you know, what I just seen with somebody else, because that was actually my reaction after I had watched the documentary. I was just like I need to get this off my chest. Like, I need to talk to somebody about what I just witnessed, because if you watch that documentary through, because there are 6 episodes. So if you watch from episode 1 to episode 6, like, I commend you, because I took 3 breaks. Like, it took me 3 days. And when I mean breaks, like, I had to come back the next day to, like, continue watching. That documentary was just, like, I have never, like, watched anything like that. And on Netflix, I have previously watched murder cases, murder trials, serial killers, documentaries. I've watched a good lump of, you know, just that whole entity of just like murder. But it's just something about this documentary where I'm just like, my heart goes out to just everyone who was affected, not just the family, but everyone who was affected. It talks about a young 8-year-old boy who endured torture, child abuse, neglect, all of that from his mom and her boyfriend. So, 3 words that I would use to describe the trials of Gabriel Fernandez, in my opinion: 1, the documentary was very deep. It was deep / graphic, in my opinion, due to
his ankles were handcuffed.
All of the pictures and audio that they aired on the documentary
caused from blunt force trauma. His hair was actually physically removed or pulled out of his head.
Over the graphics, because they did show, you know, his deceased body laid out on the hospital bed. With all of the torture and child abuse, you know, marks and things like that throughout his whole body. So that was very graphic, and it was just deep, because a lot of people can't stomach seeing something like that. But what more so got me was the testimonies when people took the stand during the trial, because having people like, you know, vocally like break down what they experience, what they, you know, just witness, like, you're just visualizing all of that while watching, you know, them say what they're saying. And it was just deep. So the second thing is sympathy. I had a lot of sympathy throughout this entire documentary, because I'm just like, I felt so sorry for this, like, 8-year-old boy. Like, I felt so sorry for him. And obviously, you know, there's nothing I can do at this point because I'm watching it, you know, years down the line. And then the last thing is anger. Like, you're just so angry while watching this documentary, especially when the mom's boyfriend,
the recordings actually describes how Gabriel made him mad, saying the 8-year-old told
killing
his mother Pearl
or
that
murdering
she leave
this 8-year-old boy. Like the way that he described
control,
how he
admitting that he hit
murdered
Gabriel
this little boy. Like you're just
angry.
Now, episode 1 shows you Gabriel being rushed to the hospital. And then once he's at the hospital, the first person to give their statement or interview on the documentary is the nurse. I'm not sure of her exact title, but the nurse is the first
I remember his
to give
throat
her,
just looked like somebody burned
she
him.
She talks about what she witnessed.
Bruising
and, how,
and cuts all over his face. Black eyes. Cuts everywhere. Like a weird cut above his penis.
When she says that his skull was like fractured and it was like lumpy. She said, you know how like most humans, their skull is round? Like his was lumpy. Like what? When the first responders got on the stand.
Strangulation marks around his neck.
Gave their testimony of just what they came in contact. Like what they, you know, experienced when they came in contact with Gabriel because they were the first responders.
Bruises.
That was a lot. Like,
skull fracture.
Just like
every inch of Gabriel was bruised and swollen.
And the first responders just say, without my entire, you know, career of doing what I'm doing, I had never seen a case to this, like, catastrophe. You can tell that the parents really had no love for this little boy. They never once asked, you know, can they, you know, go into the ambulance and ride with Gabriel to the hospital. I don't even know if they ended up, showing their face, you know, to the hospital that night. I don't think that they mentioned anything of that. But what I want to know is, like, your son just passed away or he's in critical condition and you know exactly how he got into this state. How were you able to sleep that night? Like, I have so many questions. Like, how were you able to sleep that night? How was your children able to sleep that night? Because Virginia had mentioned in her interview that she was told by her parents that she needed to clean up the blood from her brother in the living room. Ezekiel, the older brother, mentioned he had to lie and say that he was playing with Gabriel and Gabriel fell and hit his head. And Ezekiel, that's not what happened. So I'm just thinking about the mental state of the children. That's a lot. They discussed, like, when Gabriel was an infant, how, you know, Pearl, after she gave birth, 3 days later, she allowed the uncle, so I want to say her brother, to take the child from the hospital, take Gabriel from the hospital. And so then the uncle, who is gay, who has a partner, you know, spoke how he raised Gabriel. I want to say for like the first 3 or 4 years of his life and how he was in a healthy home. He loved Gabriel as if he was his own son. So somewhere within that time frame, Gabriel was now being raised by his grandparents. Gabriel then went from being raised from his grandparents to now being raised by his mom. But what I didn't understand, like what actually left me confused was, I don't know how the system works, but I was confused to find out that the mom can really just like come and take her son back when she wanted to without like having to go through like the courts or without the courts asking Gabriel, who do you want to live with? We're going to let you choose because you've been in this stable home, but now your mom wants to take you out of this stable home to raise you. Did they verify to make sure Pearl financially could afford to take care of three children? A big aspect of the trials of Gabriel Fernandez is not only was the prosecutor filing criminal charges against the mom and the mom's boyfriend, but they also, the courts were also filing charges against the social workers because the prosecutor feels like the social workers also failed Gabriel Fernandez because they came in contact with him due to the extensive amount of calls that were, you know, received to go and check on, you know, this little boy. That's when the first grade teacher gave her testimony and, you know, spoke about, you know, what she endured, what she witnessed, how Gabriel's behaviors changed with him being in first grade and her class and the projects that they worked on, the pictures that she ended up taking from what she witnessed and so forth. Because just like listening to the things that she said that she endured or witnessed when it came to Gabriel, like, it's just like, you witnessed all of this from an 8-year-old boy in first grade. Like, it just didn't make sense. It just didn't make sense to me. So, and then she talks about how, like, he came in class one day with, like, certain bruises, or he had approached her and was just like, hey, is it normal that, you know, my mom whoops me with the bell? And she was just like, you know, can you tell me more? And
Jennifer
then he
Garcia
opened up
said
and said, well, she hit me with the metal
part
and it makes
school
me bleed.
Year, telling her
and then she
was
like, where?
Home. Garcia
and then that's
immediately
what he said
reported
on my
this to the Department
so I want to say
Children
from there is
Services.
When she made her first phone call to the DCFS and, you know, actually reported what, you know, she heard, because as a teacher, you are a mandated reporter. The teacher described Gabriel coming into the classroom after being absent for a numerous amount of days. Both of his eyes were swollen. She also mentioned he had like patches in his head. She said some looked like they were healed. Others looked like they were fresh, you know, scab wounds. Then she mentioned like the scars like on his forehead. And then they showed the picture and it was just too much. It was just too much. So you mean to tell me this, that was a lot. Like that whole description of how this little boy looked, because apparently this was the worst that he had looked coming into her classroom. And just the fact, this is what I have to say in regards to the teacher. You're a teacher. And, you know, I understand she did what she felt like she could do, because she does mention calling the DCFS numerous times, the caseworkers numerous times. Sometimes she didn't even want to call them, but she ended up calling them because Gabriel ended up, you know, confiding in her and saying, when you call that lady and she comes to my house, I get in trouble even more. So she was like, it made her not want to call. But at the end of the day, she still made that phone call. But what I have to say to the teacher is, you seen Gabriel at his worst, the way you described it, and you still allowed this little boy to go home. I don't know. That's just how I'm looking at it from my standpoint. Again, I wasn't in the situation. I was not, you know, her assistant. I wasn't in the classroom. So at the end of the day, I really can't speak too much on how the situation played out, but that's just my opinion. So let's talk about when the security guard who worked at the DFACS office gave his testimony during the trial, and he talked about what he experienced when he came across Gabriel, because that also took me back and had me in tears. The security guard was on duty working at the DFACS office. He mentions how Pearl had to come in and sign some papers. And as the family is walking past his window where he's doing security, where he's on post to do security,
from a scale from
he mentions how Gabriel,
man, he was
like,
20.
Lets down his arm or lets down his sleeve,
at
or just shows his arm
by,
to the security
desk.
Guard. And the security
like
guard said, like,
and he looks at me like that with his
corner of his
eye.
That was his sign of showing me that, look at what these people are doing to me. I'm in pain. Help me.
I know.
Like,
I said, damn, man.
That shit was bad.
It's fucked up, you know?
That shit was bad. Because when you think about it, you got like an 8-year-old, you know, trying to like show signs of help me. He was like, his body was talking to me. His body was telling me, I need help. Get me out of this situation. Like, whew. That was deep. That was deep. That was deep. And I'm just like, that brings me back to like, just like how you felt watching the documentary. Like, you just felt sorry for this little boy. And it's just like, if it's not one thing, then it's the next thing. And then when you think you've, you know, been able to endure it all, and when you think you've seen it all, then during the trial, like, they'll hit you with something else, you know, something a little bit more gruesome. And you just like, dang, like, hold on. I thought that, like, there's only so much me as a human being can handle. So that's why you have to take a break watching this documentary, because just the type of just graphic details that you, that they hit you with in regards to this little boy, Gabriel, you're just like, it's only so much I can handle as a human. And so one juror had made me so mad. Like, I literally was just like boiling with anger. So let's talk about this. The Asian juror who was trying to state his case as to why he felt like the mom's boyfriend, after he admitted,
he wants to teach,
or, you know, confessed to killing Gabriel, and he gave the graphic of how he ended up murdering this little boy. The Asian juror just felt like that wasn't bounds for the death penalty. And he felt like that, you know, everybody, I guess, deserves a second chance. I think he also mentioned how that doesn't make him a monster. It was some BS. Like, I don't even remember everything that the Asian was talking about, but that just had boiled my blood so bad. Like, what are you talking about? Like, who raised you? Who raised you? That's how much I really can't, you know. That documentary was deep. And that's all I have on my chest to really talk about. Because I've had to step off camera a few times just to like reconvene and get it together, just so that way I can get, you know, my message out and, you know, actually speak about, you know, how I felt in regards to this documentary or watching this documentary. But if you haven't, I would, you know, say you can go ahead and go, I don't know. Bye, y'all.